index ring.
Yeah!
Daniels up with the basket. Go! follows on Mark Drummerhausen. That's his first personal, the Ponies third. Danielson back in the game for the Ponies. foul was on Ken Ryder. That's his first personal, the team's fifth. Eric Perch at the line with two shots. Personal, the team second. May at the line with one shot. Chad Bay. That's his second. The team's first. Mark Drummerhausen is at the line with two shots. Thank you. Kevin Syme, that's his second personal, the team's third. Mike Nelson on the line for Mountview with two shots.
Yeah.
Paula Sulak, that's his first personal.
Thank you.
Olson's basket is good. The foul is on Ryan Kraft. That's his third personal.
Everyone to ESPN's NCAA Tournament Selection Special. I'm John Saunders with Digger Phelps. And the pilot of this thing, that's a little frightening that you're going to be manning a 747, but Dick Vitale joins us. He's already made it to Charlotte. And what's your impression thus far?
Hey, John, it's going to be unbelievable. I can't wait for the selections. Let's pass out the ballots. Hey, Purdue, to me, locks up a number one seed with that great performance today.
All right, if he's the pilot, I guess you're the co-pilot, I'm the navigator. Where are you going to take us?
No, I'm the steward serving this, and we've got at-larges all over. But I'll tell you today, with Cal Irvine losing to New Mexico State, Southern Mississippi losing to Louisville, it allows two big-time bubble teams to get in.
Yeah, and a couple of those bubble teams might be with us right now. A couple of nervous coaches out there. One of them is Bobby Kremins, the head coach of Georgia Tech, who joins us now from Atlanta. And, Bobby, I got to ask you quite simply, are you a nervous wreck right now, or do you feel you are in the tournament?
No, John, I'm not nervous. I usually go to church once. I've been three times today. No, John, I think as Digger just alluded to, some of those teams losing really might have helped us, a team that could be on the bubble. But we were only one game off of 500 in our league, and we had some great in-league wins, particularly two against North Carolina. And out of conference, I think the Temple win, the Vanderbilt, St. John's, and Georgia, I feel like we really have a legitimate shot. However, anything could happen.
All right, Bobby, as you know from being around as many years as you have been, anything can happen, and it usually does. We will check with you again in just a moment. Another nervous coach standing by in Madison, Wisconsin is Stu Jackson, the head coach of the Badgers, and you have already told us you are a nervous wreck.
John, absolutely. This is worse than waiting before any game that we've played all year in the past 2 years, and simply because it's completely out of your control, we're just remaining hopeful.
All right, Stu, and we will check back with you as well to find out exactly where you're headed, if you are headed anyway. All right, we have the number one seeds now, gentlemen. So strap yourselves in and let's take a look in the East. The North Carolina Tar Heels making their 20th consecutive trip to the NCAA. They were in the number one in the East last year, and that was pretty good to them. And they went on to win it all. In the Southeast, Purdue gets it. The Boilermakers lost in the first round their last two NCAA trips. They're number one seed for the first time since 1988. That in the Midwest. Interesting, though, that they shipped Purdue to the Southeast and Arkansas to the Midwest, making their seventh straight trip to the NCAAs, all under Nolan Richardson. They've made the Final Four just four times in 19 appearances, but they got a good shot as number one seed. In the West, Missouri gets the nod, and likely the nod over Connecticut. It probably came down to one of those two, with both teams losing in the semifinal. Missouri got the nod. Dick, explain to us why Missouri gets that seed over the Huskies.
Well, I'm kind of surprised by that, with the performance of Missouri in the postseason, struggling with Colorado and then getting beat early. However, they did get rewarded for the regular season. And I think in a way you got to commend the committee for that. You go undefeated, unblemished in a tough conference like the Big Eight. I think that's why they were given that berth. And if you're Connecticut, you got to really, really be uptight. Not only do you get a number two seed, you're staring at number one, baby, in that region, North Carolina.
No, I think you're absolutely right. And Digger, that has to be the reason. Missouri going through the Big Eight undefeated, they're going to say a bad weekend is not going to cancel that out.
Well, with Missouri, you've got them where they should be. And Purdue, Michigan's loss to Northwestern set up Purdue becoming a number one seed. And wherever they go, doesn't matter. They're in that way. Connecticut, I think, John, when you take a look at their January-February schedule, they had no outside tough competition outside the Big East. That really caught up to them. And I think the power of the Big Eight, how the Big Eight did all year, carried Missouri over Connecticut for that number one seed.
Dick, I have to ask you now, you knew Arkansas was going to get a number one seed. Do you think the way the committee punished them for losing in their tournament was to ship them away from the Southeast and into the Midwest and then send Purdue the other way?
Not really. I really think what happened there, John, in a way, I think Nolan Richardson might like that, because the regional finals in Dallas, and they got a great following in the Dallas area when they used to play, for example, in the Southwest Conference. So I don't think that's a big deal. I'll tell you what surprised me a little bit there in the East. Temple dropping down to a four seed after the unbelievable year they had, and especially the fact they played one of the toughest schedules in America.
All right, Dick, thanks a lot. We'll recheck with you in just a moment, but first let's take a look at that entire East bracket. Some of it you mentioned as well. These games being played in Uniondale, New York at the Nassau County Coliseum, March 17th and the 19th. The number six seed, the champions now in the Big Eight. They won the tournament. They will face the number 11 seed in Penn, coming out of the Ivy League. It's an 11 seed. Florida, the runner-up in their conference, the Southeastern Conference. James Madison, Lefty Driesell, taking his third consecutive, or not consecutive, but his third different team into the field of 64. Did it with Davidson and with Maryland as well. UAB gets in there despite struggling in their conference tournament. They'll face George Washington, and GW was a bubble team. Connecticut drops to the number two seed in the East, and they will face the 15th seed, Rider. As we look at the rest of the East, these games being played in Landover, Maryland at the U.S. Air Arena on March the 18th and the 20th. North Carolina is the number one seed, and Liberty draws them in the first round. Washington State against Boston College. BC drops to a 9 seed despite the fact they were the number 3 team in the Big East, but they struggled in the conference tournament. Indiana probably lost out at their chance of being a top 4 seed when they struggled a bit down the end of the season. Ohio U, the champions in the MAC, first time they've been in since 1985. And Temple, as Dick mentioned, dropping to a number 4 seed. They will face the Drexel Dragons, the number 13 seed. We will continue with more in just a moment, but first let's take a look at the top seeds, where some of these conference champions have come from. Since 1979, Final Four appearances, the number one seed's gone there 25 times. And when you look at this year's matchups, this could be as well. Number one, Arkansas. Where will they be? We'll look at that in a moment.
I was in town for business, and thanks to the rental car, I have time to stop by the old neighborhood. Place hasn't changed a bit.
Room for one more? Can't be the shoes.
Want to visit your old neighborhood? Rent from Dollar. They're right on the airport, right on the money.
Hey! It's got to be the shoes, right?
Nope, it's the rental car.
Call Dollar, the official car rental company of the NBA.
Introducing the ultimate pepperoni pizza. New from Pizza Hut.
Maybe we shouldn't eat this.
What?
Zesty herbs, thicker pepperoni for a whole new taste.
It's the ultimate. We eat this now and it could ruin everything else. It's like you go out with a supermodel. Senior girls would be nothing. Susan Myers would be okay. But no supermodel. One bite. There's no going back. So you gonna eat it?
Yeah.
The ultimate pepperoni pizza. There's no going back.
The new Porsche 911 Carrera was crash-tested in this secluded building. To Gerhard Royce, who tunes the radical new suspension. To Ivanka Madsen, who stitches a cabriolet top that takes 14 hours to make. And to Stepan Rebrovich, who builds the more powerful engine by hand. This building was the perfect place for these crash tests. Why? Because it meant they didn't have to watch.
About 65 miles south of the nearest stoplight, and 2 miles up in the Rocky Mountain sky, you'll find Skier's Heaven, also known as Telluride Ski Mountain, where the skiing's perfect and the views are even better. And whether you're going to extremes or just going for a lesson, don't go without your Visa card, because at Telluride Ski Mountain, they'll let you take the plunge, but they won't take American Express. Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
ESPN's Tournament Selection Special is brought to you by Visa. It's everywhere you want to be. By Pizza Hut, who reminds you that anytime's a great time to stop and smell the pizza. And by Porsche. The people of Porsche would like to remind you that the new 911 Carrera arrives this month. Thank you.
Welcome back once again to ESPN's NCAA Tournament Selection Special. We've taken a look at the East. You know who the number one seeds are. Now let's continue to run down the rest of the brackets. We'll start in the Southeast now. Games being played in Lexington, Kentucky at Rupp Arena. The number one seed, Purdue. The Boilermakers get shipped to the Southeast. They are the outright champions in the Big Ten. They'll face Central Florida, a team that's making their first trip there. Providence, the champions in the Big East. Some thought they might get rewarded with that, with a number 6 seed or such, but they are just an 8 seed. They'll go up against a very tough Alabama squad. Wake Forest got knocked out in the semifinals, but they will face the College of Charleston, who's perhaps a surprise. That was a team that Dick Vitale felt should have gotten in. They had a terrific season, including beating Alabama by 22 points this season. Kansas, the Jayhawks dropped to a number 4 seed. They'll face Tennessee of Chattanooga. Let's stay in the Southeast now and move to the Florida Suncoast Dome in St. Petersburg, Florida. The Thunderdome as Marquette, the number 6 seed, goes against Southwest Louisiana, the number 11 seed. Kentucky, the champions now in the Southeastern Conference, get to face Tennessee State. Michigan State, a number 7 seed, they lost their last game of the season. They were going to face the Seton Hall Pirates, who may be a big surprise, losing in the semifinals, but their power rating was pretty good coming in. They do get in and get a number 10 seed. Duke is a number 2, missing their chance at a 1 seed when they lost in the ACC semifinal. They will go on to face the winner in the SWAC, Texas Southern, or Jackson State. Now, as we told you, we want to check with coaches around the country to find out their reaction. And right now, Stu Jackson reacts moments ago to watching the field of 64 unfold.
Put on CDF, guys. Back.
Yippee!
Stu Jackson was extremely nervous. We spoke with him before the show. He looked like an expectant father, and as you can see the reaction, he did get in. Let's take a look at the rest of the West. We start in Ogden, Utah, at the D Events Center. Missouri is the number 1 seed, shipped out west, but they do get the nod over Connecticut. We will talk more about that in a moment. That's what it came down to with all of the upsets. They will face Navy, the midshipmen in there, for the first time since the David Robinson era. Cincinnati is an 8 seed, perhaps a little low for the great Midwest champions. They'll go on to face Wisconsin, as you just saw Stu Jackson's reaction to his Badgers getting into the tournament. Cal is a number 5 seed. Wisconsin Green Bay gets a 12 seed. The Syracuse Orangemen, surprising perhaps, that high at number 4 because of the fact that they lost to Seton Hall in the quarterfinals of the Big East tournament. They'll go on to face Hawaii. Hawaii goes on for just the second time in the history of the Rainbows. Now we want to go back out to Madison, Wisconsin, and rejoin Stu Jackson. Stu, we saw your reaction. You're obviously extremely excited about getting in. Talk a little bit now about the first round matchup.
Well, obviously, we're really not that concerned about the first round matchup. We're very, very happy to be a part of the tournament. And, you know, we've got a lot of guys in our program that have been here a long, long time and really suffered some bad losses and some bad years. I'm just very, very happy for them. In terms of Cincinnati, I'm sure we'll get to work preparing for them tonight. But here in Madison, we're just happy to be a part of the dance.
Stu, your wins over Purdue and Michigan, did that get you in?
Well, I think it obviously was a major factor, but you also have to look at the fact of, you know, Marquette University. We gave them their worst loss of the year. And I'll tell you, I don't ever want to undersell our win against UWGB. And if you haven't seen them play and haven't had the opportunity to play against Wisconsin Green Bay, it's really a tough task.
I think when you look at your schedule, Stu, certainly it helped you. But I also think you might have got a little help at the end of the year with Northwestern, for example, beating Michigan, so it sort of negated your loss to Northwestern.
Yeah, we had two bad losses, in both Northwestern losses. But after yesterday, they don't seem like that bad. Northwestern, I believe, won 5 of their last 9 games. They're an excellent senior-dominated basketball club that really rose to the occasion toward the year's end as they proved themselves yesterday versus Michigan.
All right, Stu, thank you very much, and congratulations on the Wisconsin Badgers returning to the tournament. You've done a terrific job in a very tough Big Ten conference this year. We will have more from Stu Jackson in just a moment, but first we want to continue with our special here and look at the rest of the West region being played at the Arco Arena in Sacramento, California, the 18th and the 20th. Minnesota, the Golden Gophers, another one of those Big Ten teams coming out, a team that has struggled on the road, but of course they'll have neutral sites throughout this, facing Southern Illinois. Louisville, a number 3 seed, about where you would expect the champions in the Metro Conference. Boise State, a bit of a surprise that they came out of the Big Sky, and they get a number 14 seed. Virginia made it to the final of the ACC tournament, but before that had really struggled their way into that tournament, so they dropped to a 7 seed to face New Mexico. New Mexico had a terrific regular season. Arizona, the Wildcats, probably had a chance at a number 1 seed and lost it when they lost to Arizona State. Still the champions in the Pac-10. They'll go on to face Loyola of Maryland, a team that won just 2 games all of last year, 17 victories this year, and the champions in the Metro Atlantic. Let's move now to the Midwest, being played at Wichita, Kansas. on the 17th and the 19th. The number one seed in the Midwest is Arkansas. We'll get to that in just a moment. But Texas will go on to face Western Kentucky. Western Kentucky, one of those bubble teams that probably got in today when a couple of teams that had a chance to knock off the team for the automatic bid managed to squeeze their way out of the tournament. Michigan drops to a number three seed. They will face Pepperdine. Struggled down the stretch as well, including losing to Northwestern yesterday. St. Louis, the Billikens, had a terrific season, got bounced by Memphis in the conference tournament. They are number seven seed. And the Maryland Terrapins make the return to the tournament, the first under Gary Williams and the first since the Bob Wade era. They are a number 10 seed. UMass is a number two seed. And John Calipari, who joined us a few days ago here, Digger, will be extremely excited about that. He thought perhaps he might be a number three, but he gets a number two thanks to a lot of the upsets. They will go on to face Southwest Texas State. The rest of the Midwest, in Oklahoma City, Arkansas is the number one seed, as we mentioned. Dick Vitale says perhaps Nolan Richardson will like being shipped out of the Southeast because these regional finals will be played at Dallas. And Arkansas, the number one seed against North Carolina A&T or South Carolina State, the champion in the MEAC. Illinois goes on to face Georgetown. Illinois had a loss to Purdue today. They're around the middle of the pack in the Big Ten. Still a pretty good season. They got the big man Deion Thomas up front. They will face the Hoyas, who went to the final in the Big East tournament. UCLA drops to a five seed after earlier in the season looking like they might roll the table and get to a number one. They struggled the last half of the year about 50% in their winning percentage, and they'll go on to face Tulsa. Oklahoma State is a four seed. They reached the final in the Big Eight tournament. And New Mexico State, the champions in the Big West, just squeezing out UC Irvine, they managed to find their win. So that's a look at the rest of the Midwest. And Dick, your reaction to what you've seen there?
Well, my reaction, basically looking at all those regions, I think the toughest region is the region out in the Southeast. I really do. I think the West is really not that tough. And I think Arizona can make a little run. But also, I think the Southeast region is the toughest region.
Digger, how would you respond? You agree?
Well, you know, what really concerns me is when you look at, you know, Seton Hall was a bubble team. The win over Syracuse gets them in. And then all of a sudden you see Charleston and Tulsa sneaking in. I'm sure a lot of people are going to know why that happened. And that's where the controversy is going to start.
Yeah, well, there's always going to be controversy. That's what this day is all about, because somebody didn't get in who is not happy. But there's a lot of happy people around the country, including the Seton Halls and the Charlestons as well. Purdue is a number one seed on the power of Mr. Robinson, the big dog, carrying him on his back to a number one seed. When we come back, we'll talk to Bobby Kremins of Georgia Tech, who's on the outside looking in.
All new 1994 Lund models are available at Soderstrom's Prayer Lake Marine right now. Stop in and see Lund's totally redesigned fishing boat equipped with the most advanced line of Yamaha outboard motors. Lund powered by Yamaha stern drive is number one for quality and value. Check it out this weekend at Soderstrom's Prayer Lake Marine's all-family fishing seminars featuring Terry Tuma, March 12th and 13th. Free giveaways and prizes, too. So check out the new 1994 Lund models this weekend at Soderstrom's Prayer Lake Marine.
Take a road trip to the college championships by scoring on the phone with ESPN's three-point shootout contest. Three winners go to the College Slam Dunk and three-point shooting championship to compete for a legendary Nissan 300ZX. To enter, call 1-900-40-SHOOT. 95 cents per call, must be 18 or older, or send a postcard. No purchase or phone call necessary. Shoot to win with ESPN's three-point shootout. Sponsored by Pizza Hut and Quaker State.
Welcome back once again to ESPN's NCAA Tournament Selection Show, the Field of 64. We have shown it to you. And one of the teams that did not get in, Georgia Tech. A bit of a surprise here, perhaps, because of the two wins over North Carolina. Now, here's what they had in their favor. They went out and played everybody, no question about that. They swept North Carolina. They knocked off Temple on a neutral floor. The ACC has a very strong power rating. Against it, they had a losing conference record. They lost 11 of their last 18 games. And they lost to Florida State a couple of times. And Charlie Ward lit them up going in there when he had come back. It was on the 29th. That one was at Georgia Tech. They lost later at Florida State, but Bobby Kremins joins us now. And Bobby, I got to ask you, what hurt you, do you feel? Do you think it was a couple of losses to the teams on the lower echelon of the ACC? Did that outpower your wins over the guys at the top of the ACC?
Well, John, I think maybe what hurt us most is maybe our first game in the ACC tournament. Of course, I'll have to ask people on the selection committee. But I'm a little disappointed, not as much as my team. We're really proud of the run that we've had 9 straight years. And I really thought by, you know, helping the Georgia Tech get in that people would play anybody across the country. But more important, I was hoping the ACC would get at least 6 teams in. I noticed the Big East had 6 and the Big Ten had 7. But it's a tough job being on the selection committee, and we're just going to have to accept the outcome and just try and do better next year.
Bobby, the injury factor with Forrest, and when you look at Barry's injury, did that become a play, you think, with the committee?
I'm not sure, Digger. That's something I'm going to ask some of the people on the committee, because going down the stretch, we were without Drew Barry and without James Forrest, and I thought they were getting stronger as they were coming into the tournament. But, you know, it's hard to answer questions for the committee, but I really thought we were going to get in. I'm a little surprised we didn't get in, but I knew it would be close, and unfortunately for us, we got to now go play elsewhere.
Bobby, precedent has been established in the ACC. 7-9, Wake Forest got in 92. You looked at your scheduling philosophy, Michigan, Louisville, Vanderbilt, Temple, St. John's. Do maybe now you sit down with your staff and you say, you know what? Let's get some cupcakes, baby, and get some wins, because you played the toughest. You beat Carolina twice. I feel if Maryland's in, you should be in.
Yeah, I really thought we had a great shot because of the 2 North Carolina wins, Dick. But I'm sure they had to leave out somebody. Look at Brigham Young. I feel bad for them. I really feel they should be in. So we're not the only person. But, you know, it's all part of life. And although we're very disappointed, we have, you know, nothing to be ashamed of. We just got to keep trying harder, and hopefully we'll get back in the future.
Bobby, it's John again. You're being very gracious here on the outside looking in and headed to the NIT, if that's what you choose to do. But I got to ask you, obviously Georgia Tech is one of the best 64 teams in the country. We know that it's not the best 64 in the field. Are you happy with the format? Would you like to see it change somewhere down the road where the best 64 teams do get to go on?
Well, John, the one thing I've tried to emphasize is strength of schedule. I think it, you know, encourages people to play great out-of-conference schedules. And as Dick mentioned, you know, if they're going to base so much on in-conference, then why play a great out-of-conference schedule? But I really felt that we were heading in the right direction, and that it would encourage people, other teams, to play great teams outside the conference. That's what disappoints me the most. We were only 1 game off of 500 in our league, and we had some key injuries playing ACC games late in the season without key players. I really feel like we deserve to be in. I am disappointed, but there's nothing I can do about it right now. I feel for our players. They're a lot more disappointed than I am. But it's getting tougher and tougher. The one area that concerns me is, so many coaches, so many programs, when they don't get into the NCAA, it just adds more pressure for the future. And that will not happen here at Georgia Tech. We will continue to do it the right way, regardless of whether we get in the tournament or not. But I really felt, again, playing the great schedule, beating North Carolina twice, that we really deserved to sneak in there. But obviously, it just couldn't happen.
Bobby, did anybody from the committee contact you about the physical stature of James Forrest and Barry, if they would be ready in 5 days? Because obviously I had your game, and they were really hurting those kids physically.
Right. And Dick, I probably shouldn't have played them. And, I was wishful thinking, hoping that they would be 100%. But as you saw, they were not 100%. And, that Wake Forest game might have hurt us more than anything else. But you should never base, one game on the whole season. So what I'll do, I'll just talk to the people on the committee, Dick, and get a good feel of why we didn't get in. And again, I just don't want this to ruin the whole season. I think we have not had a great season. We've had a good season. We're really disappointed we're not part of the NCAA tournament. But it's going to be a great field. And again, we just got to move on.
All right, Bobby, thanks a lot, and I assume that you'll go on to play in the NIT if your kids choose to do so and you choose to do so, and good luck there as well. Of course, you'll see that on ESPN. We'll continue with more of the NCAA Tournament Selection Special in just a moment. But first, let's take a look at some teams who've been going consecutive for some time. Some streaks came to an end, including Georgia Tech. LSU's streak ends at 10 straight as well. North Carolina, 20 consecutive NCAA appearances. When we come back, we will look at the field more closely, including the Missouri Tigers, who, despite losing in the semifinals of the Big 8 tournament, are a number one seed.
So you've done Big Ben.
Tally, hold it.
So you've done the South Pole.
Polarized it.
So you've done the Sphinx.
Sphinxed it.
But have you done the do?
See, you've never done nothing.
Can you do the full tilt taste of Diet Dew?
Drank it. Found it, do it.
As we developed the new Porsche 911 Carrera, our German test center was buzzing with new thinking. A radical new system.
Kowski is counting on what's left of Chicago's old political machine.
Solid effort, bring Jefferson another chance.
Did you learn anything? It's your money.
Wow, you gotta keep him now.
This weekend...